One of the great things about online schools is the ability to provide a school option for any kid anywhere in the state, regardless of where they live. It is no longer defined by your zip code. It's no longer defined by economic issues. It is defined only by whether or not the parent wants the child to learn in an online school.
Have you ever said we won't need teachers anymore?
Absolutely not.
Kids can just learn with a computer
and
that's it?
Yeah,
it's as if you've said that, and they're here to dispute you on that.
Look, K12 is the largest provider of online education in grades K through 12 across the nation. What people don't understand is that we also have the largest network of online school teachers, because teachers are still central. Doesn't matter if you're learning in a classroom or you're learning in a full virtual school, teachers still matter and they're important. Excellent teachers, high quality teachers, teachers who want to be involved in helping children learn. And it's just a matter about the way in which they deliver that instruction. Instead of in a classroom, they're doing it using technology. But it allows excellent teachers to reach more kids, and that is a powerful thing. It's a great thing. We're able to take teachers who are extraordinarily talented in the subjects that they know and that they've taught, and instead of being confined to just a small class of 20 kids, now they can reach more kids than that, and at all times of the day. And they can also provide one-on-one support for those students as well.
In your own mind, as you think about this, what percentage of the pushback you get is people honestly fearing your approach to education might take on? And what percentage is a political strategy of people who, they don't care what the truth is, they want to sort of work the levers of government and the levers of popular opinion to oppose change? How much is legitimate misinformation and how much is political strategy?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both. Look, online learning is still relatively new. So obviously it's going to take a while for the public to warm to this, to understand it, and to see its benefits. But there's no question that there are political forces out there in education that don't want to bend or change in any way. They don't want to allow any reform. I think that a lot of the political opposition has little to do with the method in which instruction is delivered, the use of technology, online learning, blended learning, or online schools. I think it has everything to do with the idea that online schools provide even more school choice options. You know, great charter schools right now do not like the fact that they have to have lotteries and that they have to have waiting lists. But it's a reality because of what they're dealing with. And they would love to be able to scale and expand. Online schools can do that automatically. You can have an online school with 100 kids, and you can scale that to 10,000 kids, depending upon whether or not a student or parent decides it's the right fit for their kid. It is school choice. It's instant school choice you add to a state. And that's the wonderful thing about online schools, and I think it's why it's, for a lot of folks, it is a very real threat to them, because they see that it is very empowering for parents. More so than perhaps a small school choice program, very limited in its capacity, isolated, and able to be confined.
Parents of daughters interested in keeping their daughters chaste are known for telling them, why buy the cow if you can get the milk for free? If you'll pardon the analogy, why buy K-12 if you can get Sal Khan Academy for free?
Well, boy, as a father of four daughters, it's quite the analogy. Well, look, Khan Academy's great, but he's offering just a supplement. What we're able to do is offer a full education. Every lesson, every day, in all the core courses, plus a wide range of electives. In addition to that, counseling and advisor services, special education services. So it's a complete school that can be delivered online using innovative technology. There's a great benefit to be able to provide a lot of this new innovation that's taking place, and Khan Academy is one of them, and a lot of different things that are taking place in the technology space. And that is a good thing, and it's, you know, we use a lot of those products and services as well, too, in the schools that we operate on behalf of school districts or charter schools. But, you know, every educator would tell you that a single course or a single book or a single textbook does not itself make a school. What we're offering in a lot of states is a full online school program and a school of choice for a lot of families.
Do you serve homeschooling parents?
Yeah, homeschoolers, sure. They can purchase individual courses from K-12. We also offer a number of online private schools.
So what would students. It cost if I were a homeschooling parent and I were interested in buying a third grade curriculum?
Mm-hmm. A single course could be $250 to $450, depending on the number of materials you want to choose. So we also have online courses and offline materials. Private school tuitions, it depends. There's a number of private schools, but it could range from $5,000 to $7,000 for a full year. And
so these are private schools where there are teachers that
absolutely.
May not be near me at all, but I can use
That's
the
correct.
K-12 program. I can then converse with the teacher and
high-quality content
questions.
Experts, experts who've in foreign languages who are teaching. We can offer the types of electives that we can offer are extraordinarily broad, bigger than some of the largest school districts in the country can offer.
What are your best states in terms of percent penetration?
Some of the states, not surprisingly, where they embrace educational options, Arizona, Colorado, California, historically have been states where there's been a lot of charter schools and a lot of educational opportunities provided to parents outside of just the traditional system. So I think that's where a lot is happening. States like Ohio and Pennsylvania have been leaders for a while in that field. But more and more states are embracing. I think one mentioned it today, Montana. Some of the states,
well, not
ironically,
in raw numbers.
Yeah,
the
Northeast is generally the toughest.
The Northeast.
Yeah, and I guess a lot of that has to do with the strength of an educational establishment that is largely pushed back against providing more opportunities and options.
What would
statewide.
Be an example of a state that seems to fear online education most?
Well, New York does it, but just in a small capacity. It's interesting. Maryland. Some states that are rural too, and some states you would think would be sort of the best fit about using technology to connect students, places like Montana and the Dakotas, as well too. Some states in the South. It's really it's a strange phenomenon, but we do see every year, Bob, and I think this is why, people in the education reform and digital learning movement, folks like Governors Jeb Bush and Governors Bob Wise from West Virginia are so optimistic about this field, is because every year more and more policymakers are awakening to the fact that, look, technology is impacting and changing every industry in America. And education is always the slowest to embrace these types of reforms and innovations, but they're getting there.